رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه أما بعد. We'll continue with the battle of Uhud and all the lessons and the great legacy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in the surah of Ali Imran when he was relating the events of Ghazwati Uhud. The last thing we were talking in the introduction of the Ghazwati Hamra al-Asad. Hamra al-Asad is the place that is close to Uhud and is named Hamra al-Asad. We stopped last time about when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed in the Quran to let the believers know about those who were killed or died in the sake of Allah, and specifically the conversation, if you can say, that Abdullah ibn Haram had with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this ayat, in the ayat that Allah mentioned in Surah Ali Imran, talking about, do not think those who were killed in the sake of Allah, they are dead, but they are alive, in the Rabbihim yurzaqun. And we said the fact that they are waiting, yastabshiruna بِالَّذِينَ لَمْ يَلْحَقُوا بِهِمْ, you know, who have not, and they are with regard to those left behind who have not yet joined them in their bliss. And we said, subhanAllah, like when you look at the way of the life and the purpose of life, who is the one who is alive? When someone asks a question, who is the really one who is alive? Everyone that is alive today, he is threatened by death. And death is the reality. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us that someone will remember in the Day of Judgment that the true life starts there. Because the one who neglected his life and he wasted all his life into sinning and fighting, opposing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his sins and wrongdoing, يَقُولُ يَا لَيْتَنِي قَدَّمْتُ لِحَيَاتِ. Right? He said, I wish I have presented something today for my life. So the true life, in definition, that the life that there will not be end after it. Because any life that's gonna be altered by death or by stop of existence, if you can say. Because death is not a non-existence. It's an existence, it's a life, a different dimension. So the true life is the life that continues into the eternity. And the one who gets to that life and receiving the pleasure of Allah, that is the true life. Because in this ayah, those who already got, they are alive. But they are in the life that will not end. So them are rejoicing their state and wishing for their brother too to join them with the same condition. Because usually people alive, they're more and they are sad about those who's gone. Here we have the opposite. So a different concept on the meaning of life. Now, life, beside to breathe, to see, to touch, to express yourself, to will, it has also another definition, which is, life is to enjoy the moment that you are in, that life. If you do not enjoy it, you are in a state of anxiety and worries. So people, that moment of sadness is taken away from their life. It's a bitter moment. They wish they do not live those moments. Thus, here add a definition to the meaning of life. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the people of hellfire. قَالَ لَا يَمُوتُ فِيهَا وَلَا يَحْيَا. He is not going to die in it, and he's not going to live. Which Allah negate on him life when he feels, but he is under the torment and the doom of the wrath of Allah. So the real life, extract from this definition from the Quran, is the moment that you enjoy, but the moment you enjoy, this joy is given to you by the pleasure of Allah, and it will not have any moment of anxiety or bitterness after it. That is the life. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the life of dunya, la'ibun wa lahu, wa inna al-akhirata lahiya al-hayawan. The akhira, the hereafter, is hayawan. Hayawan is hayat, is the hayat, the life, the life. When we're looking at this ayah, yastabshiruna, the joys that they have, and they rejoicing the fact that they're gonna come to them. So those who are going to meet them after death, they live a life or they waiting for the life? They're waiting to join them, to join the real life. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who live their life according to this concept, call them rijal. Those are true men, true people, true in faith. قال من المؤمنين رجال صدقوا ما عهد الله عليه فمنهم من قضى نحبه. From the believer, true men. They fulfilled all what they had as a covenant with Allah. They fulfilled all the condition of the covenant and the oath with Allah. مِنْهُمْ مَنْ قَضَى نَحْمَةً. Some of them, they fulfilled their mission. And they die. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَنْتَظِرُ. The rest are waiting. So waiting, it will be the most befitting way, if we can say, for the true believer who wishing to meet his Lord and he's pleased with him. That's what they require here. Firmness on the path, to be steady, perseverant. And here comes another test. Now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we said after the what happened, the let's say call it a defeat in the second round, they went back to the Medina, and we mentioned last time. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said when he heard that the people of Mecca, they're gathering themselves to come back attack Medina. Coming back to attack Medina, it will be almost the end for Medina and for the Muslims. The Prophet ﷺ said, we'll go back to them. And here the condition that we said, okay, can you give us, let's say, a description of this army that they're gonna go back to the people of Quraysh, the army who just, you know, defeated them in the second round in Uhud, after the condition that we mentioned. If you look at the army of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, injured, wounded, tired, they cannot even, some of them, they cannot even walk, as we said last time. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, only those who were with me that come, the rest, no one will have the right to join us. And you know, among those people in the Medina, they were the hypocrites who withdrew themselves from even before the battle start with the disbeliever of Quraysh. Now, the question mark, it is here. It is here. Go on to portray some kind of power or seeking for a miracle to really defeat them, or there's something else. Because the believer, Ridwanullah ta'ala alayhim, all of them they rushed. All of them they rushed. Those who cannot even walk, he's being transported by his brother, carried. So injured and wounded, but the secret here is not they going out to win a battle because they are not in a condition to fight. That there is something, subhanAllah, it is the power of sami'na wa ata'na. The power of we heard and we obeyed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we know that 99 names. Huh? If you try to count, of course, the infinite names, but if you try to count the 99 names, and we say count, reflect on them, is any of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He will call you, you will have a doubt that He is not going to protect you, to shower you with His mercy, to be, you know, kind to you, and to be the one with power to watch over you. If there's any name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you look at all the names, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Al-Malik, Al-Quddus, Al-Salam, Al-Mu'min, Al-Muhaymin, Al-Aziz, Al-Jabbar, Al-Mutakabbir, Al-Khaliq, Al-Bariq, Al-Musawwir, all the names, creator, sustainer, the one who had the safe, the king of the kings, all of that. Names of beauty, names of greatness, names of power. So if He called you to come to Him, would you think of your effort to do, to face your problem, or of the help of the one who called you? And here, play your faith in the trust in Allah or not. The trust, therefore, is not that the trust that He going to save you, but the trust in how are you confident in Allah's attribute. How confident you are, how much you know your own God that you worship and you pray to every day. And the trust, it means that you really believe in what He told you that He can do for you. So when the Prophet ﷺ called them, it was maybe an opportunity for them. Look, they see it all positive because here the caller is Allah. And I say, look at all the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every name, if you reflect on it, you'll find yourself rushing toward Allah. Rushing. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most merciful, قَالَ فَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ. Don't go to Allah. Don't walk to Allah. Flee to Allah. So when the call coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they see in it all positive. If Allah wants to give them help, He had the power to give them help. If He wants to give them success and make them to defeat the enemy, He had the power to do that. If He wants to choose them, to join them, to make them join their brother who already in the bliss, they were shuhada, He has also the power to do that. Therefore, the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His messenger is only to what give you life. يَا أَيُّوَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اسْتَجِيبُوا لِلَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ إِذَا دَعَاكُمْ لِمَا يُحْيِيكُمْ. Answer the call of and His messenger when they call you to what give you life. So the call of Allah and His messenger only that give you life. Life in their call. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us an image of how, what extent you will say sami'tu wa ata'at. Qala Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here, qala alladhina istajabu lillahi wa rasuli min ba'di ma asabahumul kharah. Those who have the quality and the characteristic to be able to fulfill the condition to join those who are rejoicing, they stayed with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and waiting for them to join them. What is their condition and characteristic? That they answer the call of Allah and His messenger. Those who answer the call of Allah and the messenger, even after being wounded, those who do right and refrain from wrong have great reward. لِلَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُوا مِنْهُمْ. And أَحْسَنُ is not only do right. أَحْسَنُ is the ihsan. And the ihsan is the excellence in doing righteousness. Excellence in doing righteousness at the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, when they come to Hamra al-Asad, Yaqul Ahlul Maghazi, and Ahlul Maghazi are the narrator of the ghazawat of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the subject or of the seer, when they talking about the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. إن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم نادى في الناس وندبهم إلى المسير إلى لقاء العدو وذلك صباح الغد من معركة أحد. This is what we said. So the Prophet ﷺ called them and he said, "This next day after Uhud, let's go." And they قال لا يخرج معنا إلا من شهد القتال. No one can go with us except the one who was with us in the Uhud. And the Prophet ﷺ went and they get to a place named Hamra al-Asad. It is around 8 miles far from Al-Madinah. وهناك أقبل معبد ابن أبي معبد الخزاعي. A man came, his name معبد ابن أبي معبد الخزاعي, came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. In one narration he said that he already accepted Islam, but the disbeliever of Quraysh that he didn't know about his case. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he sent him to the people of Quraysh to tell them that the Prophet came out to them to meet them. And this is a tactic of war and battle, because they have their hearts strong alliance and strong with the trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Ma'bad ibn Abi Ma'bad al-Khuza'i, he went to the mushriks and he said, he told them that the companion and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to meet you. But in the same time, the people of Quraysh, they were like having a counseling to gather themselves and attack back the Medina, because they knew that they weakened the army of the Medina, of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they said this is an opportunity to exterminate the army of the Medina. When they were talking, they were like not really, everyone is enthusiastic to do it. And subhanAllah, this is also the thing from the Sodar of Allah that no one knows. The feeling that someone has a feeling also is under the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Doing that and listening to Ma'bad ibn Abi Ma'bad, it really threw in their heart fear. So they decided to not head toward the Medina. But in the meanwhile, one of the mushrik going back to Medina, he's not still Muslim, he met the army of Quraysh and he saw they are gathering themselves to attack Medina. That person came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to the army. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us in this ayah. Those men said to them, الَّذِينَ قَالَ لَهُمُ النَّاسُ إِنَّ النَّاسَ قَدْ جَمَعُوا لَكُمْ فَخْشَوْهُمْ إِنَّ النَّاسَ قَدْ جَمَعُوا لَكُمْ فَخْشَوْهُمْ. So a man came and he said, Ya Rasulullah, the people of Quraysh, they gathered and they are going to attack you. You should fear them, protect yourself and run away. Instead, it increased their iman, it increased their faith. Apparently it seems a contradiction. Because when someone telling you someone is coming to kill you, you have to fear him, run away, protect yourself. Instead, it will increase your security, increase your determination to stand and to meet him. That increase of faith comes its source and power from the strength of the trust in Allah. The one who called them to come to Hamra al-Asad, the one who had the whole power, he will not turn them down there. And everything, anything that is going to happen is a positive for them. Do you understand? Everything is positive. Everything is good when it comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As long as someone reach a point that he knows that he is in a good term with his Lord, it's very important. Because many people sometimes they say, I do not know if this is help or it is a difficulty. Someone, for example, passing through difficulty, he said, I don't know if this is a test, a trial, or a punishment. Other people, they have many good things. I said, I don't know if this gift from Allah was a trial to test me. The answer is, at that situation when you get the difficulty of the gift, what were the terms between you and Allah? How close were you with Allah? If you were in a state of sin, is it right to cleanse you? If you were in a state of heedlessness, you don't even care about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it has a taste of punishment in it. If you are in a state of obedience, that is a gift from Allah. Whatever form it will come to you, it is a gift to either cleanse your sins, or cleanse your soul, or cure your heart, or elevate your ranks to be closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This understanding, when they being threatened by the army coming to them, it increased their iman. Why? Because they have this strong trust in Allah and they express it. قَالُوا حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنَعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنَعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. Allah is enough, sufficient for us. Subhanallah. وَنَعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ, and He's the best to dispose of all our affairs. He one who created us, He one who provides for us, and He the one who's gonna take our souls. No one decide to kill anyone. It is Allah who allow for that soul to cease or to be taken from this life. No one had the power of the soul. Subhanallah. It's only Allah. يَتَوَفَّى الْأَنفُسِ. No one can decide of that. And all what happened is by the permission of Allah, according to the plan of Allah, and no one can kill anyone, and no soul will die, only with one condition: when it comes to the end of his term, decreed before his creation. When it comes to the end of his term, it's either someone is going to shoot him or slay him, or he will have heart attack, or sleeping and he will go, or walking and he fall dead. Why? Because his term came to an end. وَقَالُوا حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. At that moment, subhanAllah, you see, the army of the believers, their iman increased, because they know that the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with them. They know when they answer the call of Allah and His Messenger, they are in the strongest position. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there with them. And they learn their lesson from the second round of Uhud. They learn. Now they are fully obedient, fully submitted, fully trusting in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the kuffar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala threw in their heart fear. And they felt that is really great army, because Ma'bad ibn Ma'bad al-Khuza'i said, if you go up the hill, you're going to see an army is like, is filled, is going to feel like a whole field filled with soldiers. So Abu Sufyan and his people, they said, okay, it's better for us to go back to Mecca. They gathered, and when the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he stayed there in Al-Maghazi, he stayed, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, 3 days waiting for them. 3 days. And then he sent some eyes to check, and they come back, they told them, we saw them riding. They say, riding horses or camel? They say, camel. He said, then going back to Mecca. Because horses intention to attack, camels intention to leave. And the Prophet ﷺ stayed, and exactly they say here, قَالَ أَقَامَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ بِحَمْرَاءِ الْأَسَدِ بَعْدَ مَقْدَمِهِ يَوْمَ أُحُدْ الاثنين والثلاثاء والاربعاء. It was the days of Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday from Shawwal, the month of Shawwal, year 3 Hijri. Year 3 Hijri. Then ثم رجع إلى المدينة صلى الله عليه وسلم. Then he went back to the Medina. Now, here حمراء الأسد is part of Uhud. And it is, as the scholars are saying, in the third round of غزوة Uhud. And you see the victory, it in the end is for the believer. But is the victory on the battlefield with, you know, like an army and is a power or like physical victory? No, the victory that happened is in the field of the nafs. Remember, that all the defeat that the believer that they had, if we call them defeat, or what happened to them, is because of a defeat in the self. In the self. And the biggest defect is when they contradict sami'na wa ata'na. They contradict sami'na wa ata'na. They turn away because the Prophet ﷺ said, do not move. And they did. Right? So this is all the problem that they had after that. Now, coming back to show proof and repent in a way, sami'na wa ata'na. To the sami'na wa ata'na. To the bone, if you can say. And full trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah give them victory. How Allah described the victory? In the same surah, قَالْ فَانْقَلَبُوا بِنِعْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَفَضْلٍ. And they returned with grace and bounty from Allah. So after Hamra al-Asad, it was the true victory. They came back with the gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the blessing of Allah, with the bounty of Allah. It's not about spoils. The spoils, people, they use them and they eat them and they're gone. But the blessing of Allah and the bounty of Allah stays forever. فَانْخَلَبُوا بِنِعْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَفَضْلٍ. Look what he said, لِلَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُوا مِنْهُمْ وَاتَّقَوْا أَجْرٌ عَظِيمٌ. Whoever will do ihsan from them and fear Allah, he will have the most tremendous reward. And the reward started from the moment that they left Hadhrat al-Asad and they turned back with ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, gift of Allah, blessing of Allah, bounty of Allah, لَمْ يَمْسَسْهُمْ سُوءٌ. No harm has touched them. They didn't even meet the enemy. They didn't even see them. It was, subhanAllah, the victory in the heart that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it a true triumph, to make them come back and have the disbeliever leave their home to their home in humiliation, like running away. And look, the lesson here. The lesson is, if someone is defeated, the defeat comes from the soul. And if someone will have success, the success is in the soul. The defeat starts with the fear from not or other than Allah. And the success, its road, is the fear from Allah. فَانْقَلَبُوا بِنِعْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَفَضْلٍ لَمْ يَمْسَسْهُمْ سُوءٌ وَاتَّبَعُوا رِضْوَانَ اللَّهِ. All this blessing that being showered with Allah, it has for us as one lesson. What is? قَالَ وَاتَّبَعُوا رِضْوَانَ اللَّهِ. They followed what pleases Allah. If you really love that Allah be pleased with you, don't be contented with the statement that, wallahi, I want Allah to be pleased with me. My purpose of life, that God will be pleased with me. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if you want the gift, if you want the blessing, if you want the protection, therefore, you need to follow the path that pleases Allah. Do not limit yourself or be contented by only seeking the pleasure of Allah. How can you seek the pleasure of Allah with your tongue if you do not follow the path of what pleases Allah? وَاتَّبَعُوا رِضْوَانَ اللَّهِ. وَاللَّهُ ذُو فَضْلٍ عَظِيمٍ. Allah had the whole bounty subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what I said exactly here about the fear. If you fear other than Allah, that will be the beginning of the defeat. If you fear only Allah, that is the road of success. And hear what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us to remind us. قَالَ إِنَّمَا ذَلِكُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ يُخَوِّفُ أَوْلِيَاءَهُ. That's indeed the shaitan who want to throw fear in your heart from his own soldier, from his own protector, for those who work in his sake or following his way. So, يقول في مصحف الإبي وابن مسعود يخوف بأولياء. So يخوف أولياء is not like him scaring his own followers. يخوف أولياء, like he want to make you think that his follower, they have this great power. They really are people who need for someone to fear them, to be scared from them. And that will take away the energy from the believers and make them feel weak and get scared from them, and then they cannot even confront them. قَالَ إِنَّمَا ذَلِكُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ يُخَوِّفُ أَوْلِيَاءَ. So the fear from other than Allah that will cause the defeat. And قال فلا تخافون. Do not fear them. Do not fear them. Because their life is in the hand of Allah. نواصيهم بيد الله سبحانه وتعالى. It's not their forehead in the hand of Allah. Who controls the power? Them or Allah? It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So why someone will fear other than Allah when other than Allah is under the control of Allah? That's the natural fundamental of faith and the basis, the basics of faith. قال فلا تخافوهم. Do not fear them and fear Allah. If you are true believers. So when someone he finds in his heart a fear from other than Allah, this is a sign of weakness of iman. And if he want to increase and strengthen his iman, he need to work on his fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And not to fear anybody else, because anybody else is under the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَلَا تَخَافُوهُمْ وَخَافُونِ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ وَلَا يَحْزُنْكَ الَّذِينَ يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْكُفْرِ. We continue the ayat in Surah Ali Imran that describe the end of or the conclusion from the lesson from Ghazwat Uhud. قال ولا يحزنك الذين كفروا يسارعون في الكفر إنهم لن يضروا الله شيئا. And do not be sad. And you know the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he used to grieve a lot on his own people when they rejected the faith that he called them for. He used sallallahu alayhi wasallam to call day and night Allah for his people to accept the faith. He knows sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He knows what paradise looks like and he knows what hellfire looks like. قال أريد الجنة والنار. And he showed paradise and hellfire. فما رأيت خيرا من الجنة. I could not even see something look like in Jannah in good. And I cannot see or describe anything more وَالْعِيَذُ بِاللَّهِ شَرْ evil worse than hellfire. Seeing them sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he is the rahmah. Allah called him the mercy. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We only sent you as a mercy to the worlds. The mercy to the world, seeing the paradise and hellfire, how he will behave with everyone. He want them to get to paradise and shield them and save them from the fire. So from his own people who decline his message, the Prophet ﷺ, he is, when he say grieve and sad, to the point that he get to be like sick. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَلَا تَذْهَبْ نَفْسُكَ عَلَيْهِمْ حَسَرَاتِ يَا مُحَمَّدٍ. Don't kill yourself by grieving yourself and regretting the fact that they will not answer you. وَلَا يَحْزُنْكَ الَّذِينَ يُسَرُونَ. You should not grieve on those who hasten, they run toward disbelief. You call on them for paradise. You call on them for the mercy of Allah. They are fighting you. They want to kill you. And they are running toward disbelief. And calling everyone else to help them, and calling everyone else to exterminate you, and you grieve on them. You should not grieve on them, because indeed they will not harm Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are harming who? They are harming themselves. إِنَّهُمْ لَيَضُرُوا اللَّهَ شَيْءٍ.